Introduction. Bakunin's most famous work, published in various lengths, at times ending mid-second section with the line, "This is the sense in which we are really anarchists." This version is the most complete form of the work published hitherto. Originally titled Dieu et l'État, Bakunin intended it to be part of the second portion to a larger work named The Knouto-Germanic Empire and the Social Revolution. Knouto-Germanic Empire is in reference to a treaty betwixt Russia and Germany at the time, but the work was never completed. What follows is a small collection of passages representative of the primary themes of the book. God being everything, the real world and man are nothing. God being truth, justice, goodness, beauty, power, and life, man is falsehood, iniquity, evil, ugliness, impotence, and death. God being master, man is the slave, while Satan is the eternal rebel, the first free thinker, and the emancipator of worlds. The liberty of man consists solely in this, that he obeys natural laws because he has himself recognized them as such. Science is the compass of life, but it is not life itself. What I preach, then, is to a certain extent the revolt of life against science, or rather against the government of science. Not to destroy science, that would be high treason to humanity, but to remand it to its place, so that it can never leave it again. Chapter 1. Who is right, the idealists or the materialists? The question once stated in this way, hesitation becomes impossible. Undoubtedly, the idealists are wrong and the materialists right. Yes, facts are before ideas. Yes, the ideal, as Proudhon said, is but a flower whose root lies in the material conditions of existence. Yes, the whole history of humanity, intellectual and moral, political and social, is but a reflection of its economic history. All branches of modern science, of true and disinterested science, concur in proclaiming this grand truth, fundamental and decisive. The social world, properly speaking, the human world, in short, humanity, is nothing other than the last and supreme development, at least on our planet, and as far as we know, the highest manifestation of animality. But as every development necessarily implies a negation, that of its base or point of departure, humanity is at the same time and essentially the deliberate and gradual negation of the animal element in man. And it is precisely this negation, as rational as it is natural, and rational only because natural, at once historical and logical, as inevitable as the development and realization of all the natural laws in the world, that constitutes and creates the ideal, the world of intellectual and moral convictions, ideas. Yes, our first ancestors, our Adams and our Eves, were, if not gorillas, very near relatives of gorillas, omnivorous, intelligent and ferocious beasts, endowed in a higher degree than the animals of other species with two precious faculties, the power to think and the desire to rebel. These faculties, combining their progressive action in history, represent the essential factor, the negative power in the positive development of human animality, and create consequently all that constitutes humanity in man. The Bible, which is a very interesting and here and there very profound book, when considered as one of the oldest surviving manifestations of human wisdom and fancy, expresses this truth very naively in its myth of original sin. Jehovah, who of all the good gods adored by men was certainly the most jealous, the most vain, the most ferocious, the most unjust, the most bloodthirsty, the most despotic, and the most hostile to human dignity and liberty, Jehovah had just created Adam and Eve to satisfy we know not what caprice, no doubt to while away his time, which must weigh heavy on his hands in his eternal egoistic solitude, or that he might have some new slaves. He generously placed at their disposal the whole earth, with all its fruits and animals, and set but a single limit to this complete enjoyment. He expressly forbade them from touching the fruit of the tree of knowledge. He wished, therefore, that man, destitute of all understanding of himself, should remain an eternal beast, ever on all fours before the eternal God, his creator and his master. But here steps in Satan, the eternal rebel, the first free thinker and the emancipator of worlds. He makes man ashamed of his bestial ignorance and obedience. He emancipates him, stamps upon his brow the seal of liberty and humanity, in urging him to disobey and eat of the fruit of knowledge. We know what followed. The good God, whose foresight, which is one of the divine faculties, should have warned him of what would happen, flew into a terrible and ridiculous rage. He cursed Satan, man, and the world created by himself, striking himself, so to speak, in his own creation, as children do when they get angry. And, not content with smiting our ancestors themselves, he cursed them in all the generations to come, innocent of the crime committed by their forefathers. Our Catholic and Protestant theologians look upon that as very profound and very just, precisely because it is monstrously iniquitous and absurd. Then, remembering that he was not only a god of vengeance and wrath, but also a god of love, after having tormented the existence of a few milliards of poor human beings and condemned them to an eternal hell, he took pity on the rest, and to save them and reconcile his eternal and divine love with his eternal and divine anger, always greedy for victims and blood, he sent into the world, as an expiatory victim, his only son, that he might be killed by men. That is called the mystery of the redemption, the basis of all the Christian religions. Still, if the divine Saviour had saved the human world, but no. In the paradise promised by Christ, as we know, such being the formal announcement, the elect will number very few. The rest, the immense majority of the generations present and to come, will burn eternally in hell. In the meantime, to console us, God, ever just, ever good, hands over the earth to the government of the Napoleon III's, of the William I's, of the Ferdinands of Austria, and of the Alexanders of all the Russias. Such are the absurd tales that are told, and the monstrous doctrines that are taught, in the full light of the 19th century, in all the public schools of Europe, at the express command of the government. They call this civilizing the people. Is it not plain that all these governments are systematic poisoners, interested stupefiers of the masses? I have wandered from my subject, because anger gets hold of me whenever I think of the base and criminal means which they employ to keep the nations in perpetual slavery, undoubtedly that they may be the better able to fleece them. Of what consequence are the crimes of all the Trotmans in the world compared with this crime of treason against humanity committed daily, in broad day, over the whole surface of the civilized world, by those who dare call themselves the guardians and fathers of the people? I return to the myth of original sin. God admitted that Satan was right. He recognized that the devil did not deceive Adam and Eve in promising them knowledge and liberty as a reward for the act of disobedience which he had induced them to commit. For, immediately they had eaten of the forbidden fruit, God himself said, see Bible, behold, man is become as of the gods, knowing both good and evil. Prevent him, therefore, from eating of the fruit of eternal life, lest he become immortal like ourselves. Let us disregard now the fabulous portion of this myth and consider its true meaning, which is very clear. Man has emancipated himself. He has separated himself from animality and constituted himself a man. He has begun his distinctively human history and development by an act of disobedience and science, that is, by rebellion and by thought. Three elements, or, if you like, three fundamental principles, constitute the essential condition of all human development, collective or individual, in history. 1. Human animality. 2. Thought. And 3. Rebellion. To the first properly corresponds social and private economy. To the second, science. To the third, liberty. Idealists of all schools, aristocrats and bourgeois, theologians and metaphysicians, politicians and moralists, religionists, philosophers or poets, not forgetting the liberal economists, unbounded worshippers of the ideal, as we know, are much offended when told that man, with his magnificent intelligence, his sublime ideas and his boundless aspirations, is, like all else existing in the world, nothing but matter, only a product of vile matter. We may answer that the matter of which materialists speak, matter spontaneously and eternally mobile, active, productive, matter chemically or organically determined and manifested by the properties of forces, mechanical, physical, animal and intelligent, which necessarily belong to it, that this matter has nothing in common with the vile matter of the idealists. The latter, a product of their false abstraction, is indeed a stupid, inanimate, immobile thing, incapable of giving birth to the smallest product, a caput mortuum, an ugly fancy, in contrast to the beautiful fancy which they call God. As the opposite of this supreme being, matter, their matter, stripped by that which constitutes its real nature, necessarily represents supreme nothingness. They have taken away intelligence, life, all its determining qualities, active relations or forces, motion itself, without which matter would not even have weight, leaving it nothing but impenetrability and absolute immobility in space. They have attributed all these natural forces, properties and manifestations to the imaginary being created by their abstract fancy. Then, interchanging roles, they have called this product of their imagination, this phantom, this God who is nothing, supreme being, and, as a necessary consequence, have declared that the real being, matter, the world, is nothing. After which they gravely tell us that this matter is incapable of producing anything, not even of setting itself in motion, and consequently must have been created by their God. At the end of this book I exposed the fallacies and truly revolting absurdities to which one is inevitably led by this imagination of a God. Let him be considered as a personal being, the creator and organizer of worlds, or even as impersonal, a kind of divine soul spread over the whole universe and constituting thus its eternal principle. Or let him be an idea, infinite and divine, always present and active in the world, and always manifested by the totality of material and definite beings. Here I shall deal with one point only. The gradual development of the material world, as well as of organic animal life, and of the historically progressive intelligence of man, individually or socially, is perfectly conceivable. It is a wholly natural movement from the simple to the complex, from the lower to the higher, from the inferior to the superior, a movement in conformity with all our daily experiences, and consequently in conformity also with our natural logic, with the distinctive laws of our mind, which, being formed and developed only by the aid of these same experiences, is, so to speak, but the mental, cerebral reproduction or reflected summary thereof. The system of the idealists is quite the contrary of this. It is the reversal of all human experiences and of that universal and common good sense which is the essential condition of all human understanding, and which, in rising from the simple and unanimously recognized truth that twice two are four, to the sublimest and most complex scientific considerations, admitting, moreover, nothing that has not stood the severest tests of experience or observation of things and facts, becomes the only serious basis of human knowledge. Very far from pursuing the natural order from the lower to the higher, from the inferior to the superior, and from the relatively simple to the more complex, instead of wisely and rationally accompanying the progressive and real movement from the world called inorganic to the world organic, vegetable, animal, and then distinctively human, from chemical matter or chemical being to living matter or living being, and from living being to thinking being, the idealists, obsessed, blinded, and pushed on by the divine phantom which they have inherited from theology, take precisely the opposite course. They go from the higher to the lower, from the superior to the inferior, from the complex to the simple. They begin with God, either as a person or as a divine substance or idea. And the first step that they take is a terrible fall from the sublime heights of the eternal ideal into the mire of the material world, from absolute perfection into absolute imperfection, from thought to being, or rather, from supreme being to nothing. When, how, and why the divine being, eternal, infinite, absolutely perfect, probably weary of himself, decided upon this desperate salto mortale, is something which no idealist, no theologian, no metaphysician, no poet has ever been able to understand himself or explain to the profane. All religions, past and present, and all the systems of transcendental philosophy hinge on this unique, iniquitous mystery. Footnote. I call it iniquitous because, as I believe I have proved in the appendix alluded to, this mystery has been and still continues to be the consecration of all the horrors which have been and are being committed in the world. I call it unique because all other theological and metaphysical absurdities which debase the human mind are but its necessary consequences. End footnote. Holy men, inspired lawgivers, prophets, messiahs, have searched it for life and found only torment and death. Like the ancient Sphinx, it has devoured them, because they could not explain it. Great philosophers, from Heraclitus and Plato, down to Descartes, Spinoza, Leibniz, Kant, Fichte, Schelling and Hegel, not to mention the Indian philosophers, have written heaps of volumes and built systems as ingenious as sublime, in which they have said, by the way, many beautiful and grand things and discovered immortal truths, but they have left this mystery, the principal object of their transcendental investigations, as unfathomable as before. The gigantic efforts of the most wonderful geniuses that the world has known, and who, one after another for at least 30 centuries, have undertaken anew this labour of Sisyphus, have resulted only in rendering this mystery still more incomprehensible. Is it to be hoped that it will be unveiled to us by the routine speculations of some pedantic disciple of an artificially warmed-over metaphysics at a time when all living and serious spirits have abandoned that ambiguous science born of a compromise, historically explicable, no doubt, between the unreason of faith and sound scientific reason? It is evident that this terrible mystery is inexplicable, that is, absurd, because only the absurd admits of no explanation. It is evident that whoever finds it essential to his happiness and life must renounce his reason and return, if he can, to naive, blind, stupid faith, to repeat with Tertullianus and all sincere believers these words which sum up the very quintessence of theology. Credo quia absurdum. I believe because it is absurd. Then all discussion ceases, and nothing remains but the triumphant stupidity of faith. But immediately there arises another question. How comes an intelligent and well-informed man ever to feel the need of believing in this mystery? Nothing is more natural than that the belief in God, the creator, regulator, judge, master, curser, saviour and benefactor of the world, should still prevail among the people, especially in the rural districts, where it is more widespread than amongst the proletariat of the cities. The people, unfortunately, are still very ignorant, and are kept in ignorance by the systematic efforts of all the governments, who consider this ignorance, not without good reason, as one of the essential conditions of their own power. Weighted down by their daily labour, deprived of leisure, of intellectual intercourse, of reading, in short, of all the means and a good portion of the stimulants that develop thought in men, the people generally accept religious traditions without criticism, and in a lump. These traditions surround them from infancy in all the situations of life, and artificially sustained in their minds by a multitude of official poisoners of all sorts, priests and laymen, are transformed therein into a sort of mental and moral babbit, too often more powerful even than their natural good sense. There is another reason which explains and in some sort justifies the absurd beliefs of the people, namely the wretched situation in which they find themselves fatally condemned by the economic organisation of society in the most civilised countries of Europe. Reduced intellectually and morally, as well as materially, to the minimum of human existence, confined in their life like a prisoner in his prison, without horizon, without outlet, without even a future, if we believe the economists, the people would have the singularly narrow souls and blunted instincts of the bourgeois if they did not feel a desire to escape. But of escape there are but three methods, two chimerical and a third real. The first two are the dram shop and the church, debauchery of the body or debauchery of the mind. The third is social revolution. Hence I conclude that this last will be much more potent than all the theological propagandism of the freethinkers to destroy to the last vestige the religious beliefs and dissolute habits of the people, beliefs and habits much more intimately connected.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.